Ever since their first video was released in 2012, CinemaSins has become one of the most popular film-related channels on YouTube. As of the recording of this video, they have well over 8 million subscribers and regularly produce videos which consistently do well in terms of a view count. But in spite of their popularity, CinemaSins is widely regarded as a channel of poor quality. This is for a multitude of reasons, most notably their structure and overall content. In this video, I want to address the merits and flaws of the CinemaSins format and compare and contrast CinemaSins' channel to their antithesis, CinemaWins. Let's start off with CinemaSins. The structure of every CinemaSins video starts with a title intro and spoiler warning, followed by a chronological run-through of the film with narration to address sins. These sins are tallied into a number, the film is given a sentence, and the video ends with outtakes. What I want to make clear from the start is that this formatting in and of itself is not inherently flawed. In fact, several content creators who criticize CinemaSins, such as The Birdman, JXE, Sean, and Bob Vids, use the CinemaSins format as a means to respond to individual CinemaSins videos. It's a great way to make concise points and typically to address certain mistakes that CinemaSins make in their videos. All four content creators I've just mentioned use this format to great effect. So why is it that CinemaSins is so widely criticized? I would say for four primary reasons. The first is a tendency to get basic facts about a film wrong. What this leads to are sins counted against a movie being built on bad information.
Benji! Come in! Benji! Luther!
Bummer. The radios are going out. I guess because mountains? Question. If the radios don't work through the mountains at this range, how will the detonator Walker is holding work? It's also using a radio signal, yes?
Different radio signals have different levels of range. The earpieces being used by the IMF are likely meant for short distance calls of only a few miles. Therefore, the signal breaks up because Ethan has been flying for several miles through the mountains. The detonator, on the other hand, is designed to activate two nuclear devices capable of destroying an entire village. Therefore, if you activate the detonator, you'll likely want to be as far away from Ground Zero as possible. The only reason that Walker activated the detonator in the village is because he had a helicopter and knew that he could be clear of the blast radius. Not all devices that use a radio signal are designed for identical range of transmission.
Why did Cap need to make a dramatic entrance into this scene? And why on the other side of the tracks? Why isn't he helping already? In the time it took both Scarlet Witch and Proxima to figure out who it was, either of them could have potentially won the fight while the other was distracted.
Steve is standing on the side of the tracks as a distraction so that Sam can come in from the side for a sneak attack on Proxima Midnight, and for Natasha to attack Corvus Glaive from behind. Steve, Sam, and Natasha are all significantly less powerful than the members of the Black Order. Where the Black Order were able to overpower Wanda and Vision because they caught them off guard, the reason that Steve's team wins this fight is because they use the element of surprise and strategy to compensate for their lack of power. Once Sam and Natasha make their surprise attack, Steve immediately engages in the fight and serves as backup to his team members.
I want you to be by my side for it.
There is no reason to keep Marta around during the investigation, and the series of mishaps that occur afterwards will explain why you don't let civilians walk around with you during clue gathering. It's the biggest mistake Benoit makes, and luckily it doesn't hurt him or Marta in the process.
Blanc asks Marta to be his confidant because he suspects that Marta was in some way involved in Harlan's death. We later learn that this is because Blanc noticed a drop of blood that made it onto Marta's shoe when Harlan slit his throat.
When did you know I had something to do with Harlan's death?
Oh, from the first moment you set foot in front of me.
How? This movie seems to forget the podcasters were here and that we saw a giant cage door in front of the main door. We should be seeing some part of that cage coming through the glass at the very least. How did he punch through that and the glass? If he's that strong, he should have just battle rammed the door down.
Ray left the cage door open when he went outside to check on the police cruiser. When Lori saw Michael in the front yard, she instinctively locked the door and barricaded it, meaning that Michael only needed to punch through the windows of the door, which is more than possible considering the strength he's demonstrated throughout the film. All of these are examples where CinemaSins make objective mistakes in their content that results in misinformed points, which is pretty much the most foundational flaw that you can make as a movie reviewer on YouTube. The second reason they face so much criticism is their overly broad definition for what constitutes a sin. The series is called Everything Wrong With, implying that the sins in question are limited to points of criticism. This can be something in the film that is addressed typically for not making sense or contradicting itself. These can be plot holes, character inconsistencies, and contrivances which are foundational to the story and its payoffs. Or flubs, which while valid, have significantly less impact on the integrity of the story being told, and thus are considered nitpicks. However, CinemaSins lumps legitimate criticisms big and small in with other types of commentary, such as jokes, and personal anecdotes which will usually relate to something in the narrator Jeremy's life. Take this example from Jeremy's video on Joker.
If I had to walk up this set of stairs every time I went home, I would literally die. Also, yes, these stairs are real, and in New York City, and I'm adding 10 sins for all the asshats that have turned these stairs into a tourist destination so that regular pedestrians are inconvenienced. Also, I wouldn't touch either of those handrails if you paid me $100.
None of these points account for the quality of the film being heightened or reduced in any way. Jeremy simply notes that he wouldn't enjoy climbing the stairs or touching the handrails that Arthur needs to climb every day. He also blames the film for supposedly resulting in further tourist attraction to the real-life location of this film set. These statements make up for 12 sins in total, and they're nothing more than commentary from Jeremy which relates to how he would feel if he were in Arthur Fleck's position. In addition to this, there are several comments that Jeremy makes which are bizarre.
I would have removed all the sins if he had pulled out some other person from the core. Like, this is the perfect time for a Matt Damon cameo. Sure, it would have ruined all the suspense, but Matt Damon!
Matt Damon being pulled out of the silo in A Quiet Place would certainly be an interesting turn of events, but it's an insanely strange thing to note during a video review. Jeremy even admits that this would drain all tension from the scene, but he seems to believe that it would be worth every sin being removed for the Matt Damon cameo. Then he adds a sin because there was no Matt Damon cameo. Sins like these are bizarre, difficult to categorize, and nothing more than a waste of time, as they are irrelevant to the structure and craftsmanship of the film in question. And unfortunately, commentary like this is often what takes up the most time and accounts for a decent number of sins in their videos. This results in the purpose of the sin counter becoming unclear, since many different categories of commentary are combined without distinction into an overinflated number, while also bearing a name with a purposefully negative connotation. The third reason is that CinemaSins never use their points as a means to build any kind of argument against a film, and they never draw any conclusions with their evidence. Instead, the film is given a comedic sentence after its final sin tally, and the video concludes with outtakes. Most video essays on YouTube set out to achieve a purpose. For example, the universally acclaimed channel Every From a Painting used their videos to explain certain filmmaking techniques that have been used in classic movies. Their video on Akira Kurosawa, for instance, breaks down how he used movement in a film's frame in order to make a shot more aesthetically pleasing. In order to achieve proving this, the video breaks down many of the methods Kurosawa used in his films, including the weather of a scene and how people move in groups. The video then compares and contrasts a scene from Seven Samurai with Joss Whedon's The Avengers to drive home his point.
The weather, the group, the individual, the camera, the cut. But this scene tells its story mostly through dialogue. Sure, the camera moves, but it's pointless movement. For all the money that was put into it, this scene feels flat.
It's a great video essay, and it's something that can enrich your experience while watching a Kurosawa film, as you may pay attention to something in his work that you previously may not have understood. This is an example of a video that uses points and evidence to build to a conclusion, but CinemaSins does not build up key points or draw any conclusions. Sometimes points are brought up, which could make for a substantive video if sufficient evidence was presented. Their video on the girl with the dragon tattoo, for example, raises two particular arguments against the film, those being that the film's runtime is too long, thus affecting the pacing, and that the Swedish girl with the dragon tattoo is a superior adaptation of Stieg Larsson's novel. But beyond being mentioned passively, these points are never developed. And unfortunately, since CinemaSins never make conclusions at the end of their videos, the sins tally never take on any greater meaning. Therefore, if you watch one of their videos, you're unlikely to learn anything particularly substantive regarding filmmaking or film criticism. Finally, beyond basic inaccuracies and commentary lacking substance, CinemaSins frequently misses much of the nuance involved in film criticism as a result of how briefly worded individual sins are. Take this sin from Jeremy's video on the girl with the dragon tattoo.
You knew something was wrong, but you came back into the house.
But Meikle had no clue that Martin knew anything was amiss. Sure, it would have been better for him to walk away, but he was potentially going to get even more information. And really nothing would have been different if Martin hadn't noticed the knife missing. I realize this is just a crazy old loot doing some amateur philosophy, but he makes it sound like what Meikle did was entirely stupid, and it wasn't, damn it.
Jeremy seems to be sinning this scene because what Martin is saying to Mikkel is technically inaccurate, and he counts this as a negative against the film, when in fact, this dialogue is so strong because of exactly what Jeremy has just outlined. Martin has been revealed to be a serial killer in this scene who kidnaps and kills women. What he tells Mikkel is that he is fascinated by the fact that he never had to force any of his victims. Martin tells Mikkel that he knew something was wrong, yet he came into the house in spite of his instinct to run.
Why don't people trust their instincts? They sense something is wrong, someone is walking too close behind them. You knew something was wrong, but you came back into the house. Did I force you? Did I drag you in? No. All I had to do was offer you a drink. It's hard to believe that fear of offending him is stronger than the fear of pain, but you know what? It is. And they always come willingly.
Martin knew that Mikkel was up to something but didn't know to what degree, thus him offering Mikkel a drink. Mikkel went inside for the exact reason that Jeremy outlined. He is searching for all the information that he can, and what Martin had to say may have proven useful. Therefore, Mikkel chose to take him up on his offer in spite of the danger, since he had no reason to believe that Martin knew he had figured out who he was. And again, as Jeremy outlines, what tipped Martin off was the missing knife.
We'll have better luck with a gun.
I'm sorry?
When we go hunting. The gun. rather than a knife.
This is exceptionally strong character writing and storytelling, which takes the framing of a conventional horror scene and adds a clever character-based twist. Films like this tend to feature complex scenes which require time to break down. But due to how short Sins are in terms of wording, you'll almost never find this level of nuance in a CinemaSins video. All of these reasons are why people often consider CinemaSins to be a channel of poor quality. They frequently make criticisms that are factually inaccurate, provide commentary which doesn't carry any insight, lump criticisms, commentary, and jokes together into an arbitrary number, and miss much of the complexity and nuance involved in film criticism. All of this results in the content from CinemaSins being lackluster and poorly made. Now let's talk about a channel that is rarely scrutinized as frequently, CinemaSins' supposed foil, CinemaWins. Based on the comments that I've seen, there seems to be a general attitude that CinemaWins is not only an antithesis to CinemaSins, but also a channel of superior quality. One of the most popular videos critiquing CinemaSins is Bob Vid's video essay, Sustaining Stupidity, Why CinemaSins is Terrible. It's one of the most thorough analyses of CinemaSins, and I strongly recommend watching his video if you haven't already. In the conclusion of Bob's video, he blatantly tells his audience to stop watching CinemaSins and offers several alternatives, including YMS, Nerdwriter, Red Letter Media, and Every Frame of Painting. He then said he'd add more channels to his video's description based on recommendations to help people find
better, smarter, more productive content to enjoy.
In that list, however, is none other than CinemaWins. CinemaWins is a reversal of what CinemaSins sets out to achieve in their videos. Rather than creating videos to criticize films, CinemaWins sets out to praise films. But the perception that CinemaWins is a channel of superior quality to CinemaSins is not true. In fact, Lee, the creator of CinemaWins, makes many of the same mistakes that I have addressed in CinemaSins content. CinemaWins formats his videos identically to CinemaSins, with the same title intro, chronological breakdown, and sentence. But instead of tallying a sin counter, he uses a win counter, which is more or less the equivalent of cases where Jeremy removes sins from his videos.
Not gonna lie, John Wick's gear up for a fight scene is as good as any gear up for a fight scene ever filmed. I'll remove a sin.
I never really dislike suiting up scenes, but John Wick adds a whole new level knowing he's going to use every one of those weapons on someone.
The only significant difference in regards to formatting is that CinemaWins ends all of his videos with a conclusion to summarize his points. Aside from that, both channels format their videos identically. What I want to establish before going over my issues with Lee's channel is that he is very capable of making quality content. Where CinemaWins excels is when he covers films that he is clearly passionate about, or brings up unique points of praise about a particular film. Take these examples where Lee breaks down the use of color in films.
You want to talk about art? How about the color palette in this movie? Usually pretty straightforward, John gets blues and greens when he's winning, Viggo and his men get reds and yellows. You can actually predict what's going to happen based on lighting color. This dude leaves his red light and enters John's blue light of death. Now John leaves his blue and gets into trouble in the goon's red light. When he gets shot, the blue and red mix to bathe him in purple with his future uncertain. One of the few things I didn't touch on outside the obvious is the color coding of the characters. Bats is obviously always red, red, red. Buddy is blue, 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 and Darling is pink, violet. I talked about Baby's jacket being caught between his two worlds, and his glasses progressively get lighter until he's actually missing a lens by the end, showing how he's finally not blinding himself to the crime and taking some responsibility.
These are examples of excellent film criticism. They are based on accurate information and call to attention something that the audience may notice on a second viewing of a film which could enrich their experience. Lee's video on Edgar Wright's Baby Driver is a brilliant case study of the small details in a film stacking up. This is because Edgar Wright is a director who clearly cares about the small details in his films, and calling them to attention can make for solid film criticism. Once again, these are relatively small things to note out about a film, but they are built on accurate information, and Lee makes well-informed conclusions about them at the end of his videos. People often criticize CinemaSins for nitpicking films and only caring about the small details. But so long as nitpicks are based on accurate information, this can make for an entertaining and relatively harmless form of film criticism. The same prospect works in reverse for Lee with what you might call nitpicks. Lee will often find small details in films which are praiseworthy and mostly inoffensive. Wins like these are great examples of the concept of CinemaSins in reverse working to great effect, so long as Lee's nitpicks are built on accurate information. Unfortunately, these types of criticisms are not what account for the majority of CinemaWins content. As I've previously established, it isn't the formatting in and of itself which is the issue with CinemaSins or CinemaWins, it's the content. And unfortunately, CinemaWins falls into many of the same traps that CinemaSins does. The key issues with CinemaWins are wins being built on inaccurate or insufficient evidence leading to misinformed conclusions, commentary lacking in substance, repetition of points, a tendency to equivalent poor quality filmmaking to superior filmmaking, and a contradictory approach to the concept of objective and subjective film criticism. Let's first go over inaccuracies and insufficient evidence. Lee will oftentimes reach for explanations to counter flaws in films, and even blatantly invent solutions to repair events on screen not making any sense.
Next biggin is, why didn't they move to the waterfall? So many
reasons. First, they may have been planning to. We don't know. We see them over the course of 2 days. But it's likely that they didn't always know about it and have created a life and a system on their farm that's safe and works. Also, can you imagine moving? Moving all your stuff and building a new house isn't exactly a quiet project. But I think the biggest thing is that, while yes, the loud sounds of the rushing water drown out other sounds, it's not foolproof.
Lee is responding to the classic argument about why the waterfall wasn't used by the family in a quiet place. Among many reasons, Lee argues that they may have been planning to, that moving there would be impractical, and that the waterfall isn't foolproof. While we do see the family living there over the course of 2 days, as Lee said, they have been living at the farm for at least a year. The fact that the family has a fishing system there also demonstrates they have known long enough to see the benefits of the river and take advantage of them in the form of fishing. Lee is correct that moving to the waterfall would be impractical, but as he later outlines,
I see post-apocalypse hierarchy of needs as follows. 1. Survive, which includes food, water, and shelter. 2. Prepare, that's the lights, fireworks, the baby's room, and coffin crib. 3 is improve. That's the chilly warning lights, learning to wash clothes super quietly, spreading sand out over your most traveled areas, etc.
Finding a way to minimize risk by taking on initial inconvenience would certainly fall into the realm of improvement, and it would remove the need to reduce sounds in everyday life, leading to a safer situation for the family. And lastly, Lee is correct that the waterfall isn't foolproof, but we only have what the film tells us to go on, which is that small sounds are okay since the river is loud. Later on, the audience learns that you can yell at the waterfall due to how loud it is. However, the scene between Marcus and his father demonstrates that it's safe to speak at a normal volume near the water around the waterfall. The film shows the audience that the river provides a cover for the noise to reduce the risk of being heard. Reducing risk is one of the most foundational elements of survival, particularly in the situation that the plot of A Quiet Place revolves around. Yet the characters blatantly ignore it as a resource outside of fishing and casually talking, meaning that the river and waterfall is a significant hole in the plot of A Quiet Place.
One of the biggest questions that comes up in reviews is why the Suicide Squad? Why not send Batman, Wonder Woman, and the Flash? The reason is that Waller needed some expendable goons she could control since she created the entire catastrophe. It's that simple. The first mission was rescuing her, where she planned to execute a bunch of underlings, solidifying her ruthless status. Do you think Batfleck would have been on board for that?
The purpose of creating Task Force X in the film Suicide Squad was all about protecting the world against metahumans. Amanda Waller specifically talks about how Superman shared America's values, while the next Superman may not.
You know what the problem with a metahuman is? The human part. We got lucky with Superman, he shared our values. The next Superman might not.
When talking about how they can combat against metahumans, Waller pitches the members of the Suicide Squad. And when Task Force X is pitched to the members of the Pentagon, this is their opening statement.
What if Superman had decided to fly down, rip off the roof of the White House, and grab the President of the United States right out of the Oval Office? Who would have stopped him?
Superman is dead.
But who would have stopped him?
Batman would. We'd call Batman. Why are we talking about this?
I think we should use bad guys.
The criticism about why Waller assembled the Suicide Squad is the power levels of the specific members. A man who can climb anything and a psychotic woman with a baseball bat would never be able to take on someone like Superman in terms of sheer power level, making Waller's plan ridiculous at face value. Enchantress only escaped from Waller's control after Waller had assembled Task Force X, making Lee's defense a post-hoc rationalization.
Okay, so Yoda blew up the tree with Force Lightning, Luke projected himself across the galaxy, and now Luke catches the lightsaber. We know that Octu is an important place for the Force, so it stands to reason, strong Force location, strong Force ghost powers?
Lee posits this explanation in the form of a question. Yet again, this is another post-hoc argument built by past events to form an explanation. In the previous Star Wars films, the audience never saw the Force ghosts interact with environments outside of communicating with others. Since Force ghosts can't die and there would be no risk for a Force ghost in combat, audiences were led to assume that the Force ghosts could only communicate with others and not physically interact with them. Yoda using lightning to burn down the tree in The Last Jedi was the first instance where we saw Force ghosts being able to interact with the physical world. The Rise of Skywalker confirmed this beyond a shadow of doubt by having Luke catch Anakin's lightsaber, raising the question of why Force ghosts can't help in battle situations. Any argument that can be made, including Lee's, is post-hoc considering that there is no mechanical reference for how the Force ghosts function. Force ghosts appeared on Hoth as well as Endor in the OT, and there was no implication that they couldn't go where they wished. The sequel trilogy is the first instance where we see Force ghosts interact with the real world, yet they never assist the film's heroes in spite of all evidence telling the audience that it is possible. And noting that they appear on the island in the sequel trilogy does not mean that they can't leave the island, meaning both cases of Force ghosts interacting with the world are significant retcons to the mechanics of Force ghosts in the Star Wars universe. To be clear, these kinds of inaccuracies and stretches in interpretation are far less common than CinemaSins videos, which almost always get information consistently wrong. But these kinds of mistakes are typically found in Lee's videos about films that are widely criticized. And in spite of his channel's heading saying liking things is more fun than not liking things, there really are some films with irredeemable flaws that can't be hand-waved with a half-baked explanation. Just like CinemaSins, what usually fills up most of the time in a CinemaWins video isn't criticism, it's commentary and jokes. And unfortunately, what this leads to is an overabundance of superficial points as well as points of praise which are repeated.
Brutal. Brutal. And some serious beast mode.
It's a yup for me, dog.
Also yup.
Yep. Also yup.
Yep. Daniel Craig, a murder mystery, and Christopher Plummer? Is this the girl with the dragon tattoo? Toni Collette, a story about someone slowly being poisoned and a twist ending? Is this a Sixth Sense? Daniel Craig, a non-American female lead and someone who uses their tail as a trick? Is this Casino Royale? I did it. I got three.
You're repeating yourself, you know that? You're repeating yourself.
You're repeating yourself. You're repeating yourself.
With Jeremy, what you often get is a lack of understanding in regards to the nuances involved in quality films. Lee, on the other hand, will often downplay the magnitude of certain flaws in films of poor quality. Typically, this is done by associating one film to another and creating a false equivalency. Take this example from his video on Ridley Scott's Prometheus.
Well, that escalated quickly, but it wouldn't be an alien movie without some kind of scientist ignoring all safety precautions or animal warning signs like hissing, leading to their ultimate demise. Just ask John Hurt, aka King.
What Lee is attempting to do with this win is to equivalent the character's actions and events of Prometheus to those same elements from the original Alien. What he is implying is that these complaints that the character's making idiotic decisions in Prometheus is also apparent in the original film, which is widely considered to be a masterpiece. However, in comparing these two elements in detail, Lee's argument instantly falls apart. In Alien, the crew of the Nostromo is searching the wreckage of a ship after following up on a distress signal. Kane is lowered into a cave when he stumbles upon what he believes to be eggs. He approaches one of them, and after he touches the top, Kane notices that there seems to be life in it.
Wait a minute, this movement seems to have life. Organic life.
When the egg opens, he leans in to get a closer look, only for the facehugger to latch itself onto Kane's face. Following this, the crew attempts to get back into the Nostromo to get the facehugger off of Kane. Ripley refuses to open the hatch and reminds Dallas about the quarantine regulations being 24 hours for decontamination.
If we let it in, the ship could be infected. You know the quarantine procedure.
24 hours for decontamination.
In spite of Dallas's direct orders, she stands her ground, only for Ash to open the hatch in direct violation of the quarantine regulations. These two scenes are what ultimately lead to the xenomorph being born inside Kane and result in the events of the film unfolding. However, in both cases, there are either visual or character-based reasons for why safety procedures are broken. In the scene involving the egg, there were no immediate warning signs such as hissing or violent movement which alerted Kane that the egg represented potential danger. The egg opened quietly and was sitting silently for several seconds. Yes, he had seen movement inside the egg, but there was nothing which would give him the impression that what the egg was housing was an immediate threat. Therefore, he looked over the egg to get a closer look before being attacked. In the second scene, the characters are all fully aware of the quarantine regulations. Dallas and Lambert are opting to break them because they believe that Kane will die in 24 hours and that his life may be saved if they manage to get the facehugger off.
He could die in 24 hours. Open the hatch.
Listen to me. If we break quarantine, we could all die.
Could you open the goddamn hatch? We have to get him inside.
Ripley cares about the crew but chooses to keep the hatch closed because she is a by-the-book character and refuses to violate quarantine regulations. The one who ultimately allows for the hatch to be opened is Ash, who just like every other character in this scene has a reason for why he broke regulations. This being that Ash is secretly an android and has been ordered to bring back the alien even if it results in the death of the crew. The events of Alien are all a direct result of the actions of the main characters. In the case of the scene where Kane is infected and brought back to the Nostromo, there are specific character-based reasons for why the crew members ignored safety protocols. On the other hand, Prometheus is a film filled with characters who are placed into peril almost exclusively by virtue of them being inept or idiotic. The scene Lee is referring to involves the characters Fifield and Milburn. Fifield somehow manages to get lost and left behind by the crew of the Prometheus, in spite of the fact that his pups map the entire cavern and that the Prometheus has a map and direct communication with them. Rather than relying on contextual character-based reasons for why Fifield was separated from the group, the writers simply opted for him and Milburn to get lost, in spite of Fifield's occupation and technology giving the audience the impression that he should be able to make his way in the cave. Following this, the two men come across several snake-like creatures in the black liquid. Despite showing immense fear when being in a hall with dead engineers and walking in the opposite direction of a potential life ping, Milburn interacts with the creature seemingly hypnotized by its apparent beauty. When he comes closer, the creature audibly hisses at Milburn.
It's okay. It's okay. It's okay.
okay.
And when he eventually attempts to pet it with his hand, the creature wraps itself around Milburn's arm and breaks it, eventually leading to the death of both men. The fundamental difference between these two scenes is that the safety protocols in Alien are broken for character-based reasons, while the characters in Prometheus are inept in regards to their position as scientists, and inconsistent in regards to how fearful they are in the face of alien creatures. Wins like these from Lee are why many of his comparisons to classic films are blatant false equivalencies. He forms conclusions based on oversimplified or inaccurate information about films, thus leading to a form of conjecture within his assessments. The last area of Lee's content that's worth exploring are his rather contradictory statements about the purpose of his channel. This is where the conclusions of his videos are critical to study. One of the most interesting examples is his video on Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom. In this video, Lee directly addresses the concept of objectivity versus subjectivity.
You'll notice in my videos that I generally refrain from talking about whether movies are good or bad, and that's because I don't think entertainment value, which is a lot of what my channel is about, can be judged objectively. Screenplays, acting, plotting, lighting, filming, all that stuff can be judged objectively. But usually I just don't see the point, especially if something was entertaining in spite of any potential objective failures.
Lee is absolutely correct that entertainment value can't be judged objectively. Entertainment is an inherently subjective reaction to content which will vary from person to person. Lee claims that his channel is primarily about assessing entertainment value and not about judging if films are good or bad. In spite of this, he believes that aspects of film such as screenplays and filming can be judged objectively, only that he personally doesn't see the point in engaging in this form of criticism. However, this goes directly against statements Lee made in a previous video about Batman v Superman Dawn of Justice, where he had this to say.
This channel has always been about the great things that actors, directors, composers, cinematographers, and even the occasional producers do.
Through the argumentation that Lee regularly engages with in his videos, it's clear that he isn't only trying to assess entertainment value. He is trying to argue for a film's quality and to praise what he believes to be praiseworthy films. Lee expanded on the purpose of his channel in one of his latest videos about Star Wars: The Rise of Skywalker.
This video feels like a good time to briefly remind you, my dear viewers, what this channel is about. While it started out a lot more tongue-in-cheek, it quickly became obvious to me that bad movies had fans who enjoyed them, unironically. So slowly, the bad thing but I'm pretending it's good shtick disappeared and I went looking for more sincere points. Although you guys don't begrudge me a few here and there. I do argue against and defend perceived problems, but unless I come right out and say it, the wins aren't about judging whether a movie is good or bad. That's just not what I'm interested in doing with this channel. My mission statement has become, every movie is at least one person's favorite and I want to try to figure out the reasons why.
Once again, Lee is reaffirming that the concept of his channel isn't about assessing whether films are good or bad, and the concept of trying to find out why people enjoy films is a rather amicable one. However, what throws the wrench into his statement is that Lee argues against perceived problems with films. For one, Lee previously stated that he believes that screenplays and filming can be judged objectively, but that he doesn't see the point since his channel is mainly about entertainment value. It could be that Lee is attempting to play the devil's advocate, and argue for how people explain these issues in their minds to enjoy films more easily. But just like Lee addressed, objective assessments of films shouldn't necessarily tie into a film's entertainment value, which ultimately calls into question why Lee would use objective argumentation when combating against a film's flaws. The last conclusion that I'd like to examine is his video on Joker, where he stated this.
Every movie has a slew of problems from the overt to the minuscule. Flawless movies don't exist, and whether those flaws bother us depends in large part to how we feel about the movie. Every single movie will fall apart when you start picking it apart objectively. I'm not joking. Lord of the Rings is full of plot contrivance, plot convenience, characters acting like aliens, and often just plain hot nonsense on more than one occasion.
This last statement is where I believe the key issue with Lee's channel lies. Clearly, he is attempting to praise films and help his audience enjoy films that are popularly perceived as bad. Obviously, he's correct that people's feelings on films matter. However, he seems to believe that objective critique is pointless because all films are flawed. Lee uses The Lord of the Rings and Taxi Driver as broad examples of this. While it may be true to some degree that there are flaws that can be found in just about every film, there are plenty of films which clearly put in the work to deliver tight scripts and sharp direction. What I would argue is that these films are worth celebrating just like Lee celebrates films on his channel. However, just because plenty of quality films feature flaws doesn't mean that we should sugarcoat films filled with glaring plot holes and inconsistencies just for the sake of helping someone else enjoy said film more. You do not have to misrepresent a film or invent explanations to objective flaws in order to praise said film. Those are some of the primary issues regarding CinemaWins' channel. He makes conclusions based on faulty or lacking evidence, he inserts commentary and humor into his videos leading to repetitive points and points lacking in substance, he equivalates popularly criticized films he is assessing to films often considered masterpieces in an effort to downplay the magnitude of a film's flaws, and the goal of his channel in regards to objective and subjective film criticism becomes murky due to him regularly using objective argumentation in his content. To be fair, CinemaSins and CinemaWins give their audiences exactly what they want to see. an assessment of a film which is only positive, and an assessment of a film which is only negative. If there's one issue which plagues both channels beyond their restrictive formatting, it would be the simple nature that not all films are strictly good or bad. A lot of what film criticism revolves around is an approach somewhere in between what CinemaSins and CinemaWins do on their channels. Both Lee and Jeremy are capable of creating quality content, and if scrutinized enough, hopefully they will both make significant changes to their channels over time. But both channels seem to have found their audiences, and to that, I say more power to them. However, the key point I wanted to drive home with this video is that CinemaWins is not a superior quality antithesis to CinemaSins. Not by virtue of being positive, and not because Lee writes superior quality scripts to Jeremy. Lee's videos are regularly filled with flawed argumentation, repetitive and vapid points, and a channel purpose which seems to change depending on how Lee wants his audience to feel about a particular film. Lee is the creative force behind CinemaWins, and he deserves every bit of scrutiny that his negative counterpart receives. Therefore, when it comes to both channels, for the time being, my conclusion is, nobody does it better.
Well, they're just coming right out with it. He's back. It seems like your enjoyment of this movie could very easily boil down to that one plot point because so much hinges on it. I guess I'd say pretend for a watch through that it's what you wanted and see how you feel. Call me in the morning.